All right, looks like we are live.
We are? How exciting. I'll go to the live dashboard and see. Stream is offline, it says. There we go. We're streaming. Now we're streaming. Nobody here, but we're streaming. So we should just jump into the show as though somebody might wander up later on and, you know, somebody might wander in and say hello.
Somebody might wander in and say hello.
Yeah.
Could really? Happen. It could happen.
Sometimes I fantasize about this show being professional, right? And the whole idea that we go live and we immediately jump into the show instead of standing around talking about, you know, maybe the people will come, maybe they won't, blah, 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 the whole thing. You know?
Well, I try.
It's not you. It's not you, baby. It's me. How many times have you heard this in our life?
A lot.
You know, wondering hello.
Well, look, see, I can broadcast on Facebook. I don't know what the stream is like on Facebook, but
are you on the? Are you streaming?
Live on Facebook as well. Mondo's going to help me figure out if I can post to the group instead of a live event. But for right now, I can broadcast it to Facebook. It's just got to be on my wall, which I don't mind. I don't care. People can watch it. People don't want to watch it. I don't give a shit. So it's just live.
I don't know. All I know is that it's time for me to check the stream health. It is healthy. So we got that going for us.
See, XSplit has an option that says I can broadcast to a group, but when I click on that, it's asking me for the post as, and it won't let me select my name, even though I'm an admin in the Cirque. So I don't know if it's something that I'm doing wrong, or I don't know how to
Keith, you can go live any place but a group right now.
Because I was trying to do it in an event, but it's only the little small screen.
I don't know. Could you click on the small screen? And
I don't know. Should I try to?
I'll go. You know what? You entertain the people, and I'll go look.
Okay. So anyway, how y'all doing? I'm trying to keep track of two chats since I am live on Facebook as well as live on YouTube.
That'll be fun, keeping track of two chats.
Trying to keep track of two chats here. So,
that's silly,
hey Carol, how's it going?
Silly to keep track of two chats, isn't it?
No, not really. No one's watching this on Facebook.
Well, let's see. Does it say that we're live? It says you were live. It does not say that you are live now.
No, because I'm broadcasting it to my wall, my personal page.
Oh, now I gotta go.
Should
to
I
wall.
Change okay. it back to the Jeez. Group event? I can totally do that. It's not that hard.
No, you're not broadcasting to your wall right now.
It says I'm live.
Well, I don't see it. Every week the show starts the same way. Us talking about getting our stream going.
It says I'm live. I'm looking at it right now.
Well, good. You get to look at it. Here it says, it does not say that you're live on your wall. Unless it's someplace weird.
No, I just clicked on my name and it just says that I'm live.
It says that you're live somewhere. Where does it say that?
I don't know. It's just I clicked on my name and it's just like live.
Wow, I clicked on your name and it doesn't show anything.
Really?
Of the sort. Yeah.
That's weird.
Maybe we're not Facebook friends. I don't know.
No more Facebook friends.
I know. You know. So, hi.
Hi.
Big news in vaping this week, huh?
Lots of news in vaping this week.
Was there lots of news or just big news from one company?
Big news from one company.
Yeah. How do we feel about this?
I have mixed feelings because I'm kind of sad that a company is going out of business. But you know, I mean, if they're going out on top, then, and I'm happy for them, you know, but I'm sad that, you know, it's come to this. So,
well, hey, Keith, which other company shut down this week? I wonder. Maybe you could tell me that. I kept hearing another company went down. I don't know which one it was, though. So let's do this. Okay. So let's, you know, let's have this very open discussion. And I want to stipulate from this two veteran companies, ProVape and Vermont something.
Vermont.
Got it. All right, so Vermont something is gone too. So let's just start out first of all with the and I want people to accept something that I'm going to tell them at face value, and that is that I have known a lot of about what's going on at ProVape for a very long time. And the reason that I've known a lot about ProVape for a very long time is because they were my biggest distributor. Okay. They sold the Kabuki, and they sold the Kabuki in 168 countries. Okay. So that's one thing. And that's very important to understand, that ProVape was in a lot of places. Number two, I sold originally with them the Z80 Pro, and we sold, you know, tens of thousands of Z80 Pros to them, as well as tens of thousands of Kabukis. So we did a lot of business through the years, and you know, they did a lot of business, and they continued to do a lot of business up until the point when they decided that they were going to close. And there's two reasons why a business can close. Well, there's more than two, but there's two primary reasons. Number one is because you can't do enough business to stay in business. And number two is you're doing a lot of business, but you're tired and you want to get out of the business.
Yeah.
And you would like to, if at all possible, sell your business, and to, you know, to keep it going, keep people employed, that sort of thing. But you know, maybe your business isn't saleable, but you still don't want to be in business, and you don't want to feel like you're trapped by your business, and you don't want to become a prisoner of your business. Now, which do you think happened? Do you think that they went out of business because nobody in America wants a ProVape?
No.
Or do you think that they went out of business because they're tired, they wanted to sell their business, and they couldn't find a buyer?
I think that they just didn't want to be in business anymore.
Right. So, you know, there was a lot of talk the last 2 days since they announced about how they failed, they didn't keep up with the times, they didn't this, they didn't that. People need to understand something, and it's really, really important to understand, and American vapers don't get this. Cloud blowing is a North American thing, okay?
Yeah.
Up until recently, it was a USA thing, but it's finding its way into Canada. The rest of the world finds cloud blowing to be classless and offensive, you know?
Yeah.
And so the fact that the ProVary wasn't 300 watts isn't why they went out of business. The fact that they didn't keep up isn't why they went out of business, because when you make a product that's geared towards helping people quit smoking, yes, first of all, I just saw Joanne say Aussies have been cloud blowing for years. The ones on Facebook have, but by and large, they find, the Facebook communities, the online communities blow clouds, and it's kind of their thing. But the rest of the world thinks that cloud blowing is classless and offensive. I think it's classless and offensive. And a lot of the majority of the people do.
Hey, it's JoJo.
Smokers want easy and reliable, you know, and ProVape is easy and reliable. Okay, it was an easy product to use. It was a reliable product, and it did what it needed to do. The bottom line is that David and Phil, the owners of ProVape, were two very good close friends of mine that I did business with for 5 years. We're tired. Okay, tired of hearing people yelling at them for not keeping up, tired of this, tired of that. And by the way, they're doing pretty good in life. Their business was very, very successful. And you can say, Mike, you don't know if their business was successful. And I say, yes, I do. The reason I can say yes, I do is because I know how many kabukis I ship to them. Mm-hmm. ProVape did not ever make an internal lipo device. The reason that I know that ProVape was successful is because I know how many kabukis they bought, and I know how much of that product that they were moving. And you know, they were selling 10 ProVaries to every or more to every kabuki that went out the door. And I know who they were distributing to, and I know the kind of business that they were doing as well. They were a solid company and a strong company and a company that was, the day they closed, they were showing a profit. How do I know they were showing a profit? Because I, myself and another group of people knew that ProVary was going out of business in June of last year. And because the company was for sale, and I, led up a team of people that were trying to buy ProVary. We were trying to buy ProVary or ProVape for the purpose of keeping that business alive. And I led two different investor groups down the path of trying to buy that business, which was very much for sale. We had an agreed upon price, and at two different junctures, the deal fell through. And the deal fell through for one reason and one reason only. The deal fell through because people that weren't in the e-cig industry, that were venture capital people and were part of investor groups, could not see investing in that company with the FDA regulations being so pervasive and so over the top in terms of how it was going to affect devices.
Yeah.
The FDA didn't kill the deal once, it killed the deal twice. And with all of the assurances that we could keep it going without the USA, wasn't enough to convince the investor groups to keep it going. But I know what their bottom line was, I know what their expenses were, I know what their profit and loss statement looked like. I knew all of it, and we tried to save it. But we just couldn't get a bank buy-in. We couldn't get a private investor group buy-in. There was just no way to make it happen because of the FDA. And all of the unknowns that were created by the FDA. Now you could say, Mike, you know, that's great. You know, if they were really strong in other markets, if they were really, really strong in other markets, then why wouldn't you just buy it and not sell them in the United States? And that was my argument, was why don't we just buy it and not sell them in the United States? But U.S. investors don't like buying companies that make products that you can't sell in our own country. It was virtually impossible to do that. But I don't shed any tears for ProVary, for ProVape. Don't shed any tears for them. David and Phil ended up on a high. They owned their building, they sold their building. They owned their equipment, they sold their equipment. They had a solid business, they had intellectual property, they've sold off some of their intellectual property, but not necessarily to the vaping industry. And the other thing is, they went out for them, not in their biggest year that they ever had, but in a solid year. And they're fine. You know, the owners of that company are okay. They gave their employees a bit of a kick out for sure, but the owners of that company didn't lose their shirts. They're in a better place in life than they were before they started. They're fine. And in fact, David and Phil, at under 50 years old, are both now retiring.
Nice.
And
good for them.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the thing.
That's the American dream right there, right?
They deserve a rest. Okay. And I keep in touch with David, and he and I sometimes talk to the wee hours of the morning. Of course, it's not the wee hours of the morning because he's 3 hours ahead of me, but whatever he is behind me. They're fine. Those guys are going to be okay. Yes, their employees, lost their jobs, but some of that went through attrition. They knew they were shutting down.
Hey, not.
And as people left, they didn't replace them. So
got vape and militia up in the house with Noct and Mondo.
Yeah, we have some vape and militia here.
Oh, and Jen says, do you think the FDA is going to make selling anything but cigalites impossible in the U.S. for all companies?
Jen, I don't know.
We'll see. We'll have to wait and see.
We'll see. I mean, things. It's very much a moving target.
Can you see my zombie? You see the coloring on it? Probably not.
I mean, it's very much, very much a moving target as to what's going to happen here. We'll see. And I wouldn't be the one to try to guess. I just know that what we have going in this country is not a good business climate. We were looking at a solid business that had been in business since 2009. It was in the black, and never in the red. And showing a profit year after year after year, showing growth for 5 years straight before there was a slight downturn. And we couldn't pull funding together to buy the company because these regulations are a complete unknown, and it's a total crapshoot as to how we would move forward in the event that we got shut down by the FDA. There's another thing going on which is less talked about in the industry but still a huge concern. And there's an old saying from the Caribbean, specifically Jamaica, that goes like this: the higher the monkey climbs, the more it exposes. I love that. I love that phrase. I love the imagery of that. And it's true. The higher the monkey climbs, the more it exposes. And when a company gets as big as ProVape, doing millions of dollars a year, you become a target for those that are litigious. Okay.
Uh-huh.
If you're a lawyer that's trying to build a portfolio of business, and there are lawyers building portfolios of business, there are conferences where at these conferences they talk about how are we going to get involved in suing people involved in the e-cig industry. The biggest companies are the ones that are going to be targeted in these suits, and ProVape had already been sued over a Prop 65 warning on a e-liquid bottle, and they settled it out of court for a lot of money because it was going to cost a lot of money to defend it, and they were still going to lose because the Prop 65 label was not on the bottle.
Mm-hmm.
It was a bottle that had been shipped into California after the legislation was in place, but the lawyers there decided we're just going to start prosecuting everybody under the sun. And until we can find somebody who will pay up,
mm-hmm.
and off you go. So they got sued, and then they realized the longer they stay in business, the more they're exposed to these lawsuits. you know?
Mm-hmm.
And here's the thing, if you stay in business, let's say you don't sell to the United States anymore, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're selling to China and Malaysia and on and on and on and on and on, right? If you're still in business, operating a business in the United States, you're still subject to those lawsuits, even if you're not selling to the USA anymore, right? So that makes them a huge target, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That makes them a huge, huge target. And they were at a point where they had a lot to lose. So let's just say that happens. You've built a business, you're going great, you're going strong, you decide, you know what, I won't sell to the US market anymore. These FDA regulations are too tough. And then something that you sold while you were still selling to the US market, something goes wrong with it, you get sued because you're still there.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And by the way, Jen, it's impossible to sue the Chinese companies. You can only sue the importers. As a matter of self-preservation, it made sense for them to, if they weren't going to sell to the U.S., don't sell anywhere. And that's where it went. But they are very much a victim of the prevailing climate in the vaping industry. Very much a victim. The FDA regulations made it impossible to sell their company. The FDA regulations made it nearly impossible for them to consider moving forward. You need a PMTA for every SKU. They had a lot of SKUs, okay? And that's a huge issue. That's a very big problem. The cost of staying in business was too great. The cost of going out of business was lower, and they got to retain their earnings. So what would you do? You know, what would you do if it was your company? You know, people say I'm pretty stupid for staying in business myself, you know, especially since with them going out, it gives me an opportunity to say, well, they were my biggest distributor. I'm going to call it quits too. You know,
mm-hmm.
That would be very easy to do, but I'm not doing that. I'm going unicorn hunting.
Unicorns. Getting in the squatty potty business? No, I'm just kidding.
No, there it is, folks. There it is. That's a unicorn slug right there. If you want to hunt unicorns, you're going to need some unicorn slugs.
Hey, so it's Jeannie. Hey, Jeannie.
Hey, Jeannie's here. Yeah, most of the vendors selling Chinese stuff don't realize they are now the manufacturer. If they are importing it for the purpose of resale, the FDA is treating them like a manufacturer.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know why. Doesn't make any sense. So, but they said no new products in the market after 8/8. There has been a flood of new products in the market since 8/8.
Yep.
I
had to send an email yesterday about a new product with trademark infringement.
Great. Hey, Jeannie.
They don't carry
the correct product liability policy. The problem, Noct, is they can't get the correct product liability policy. Since the proposed deeming. Nobody could get product liability insurance unless they already had it. Okay. Now I did. So I got to keep it, but it went way up. But nobody knew in this industry, anybody that came into this industry after April of 2014 has not gotten product liability insurance. All new companies, all new products, other than unless you already had it, is not going to get it. But you're going to see them starting to get it because UL has just this past week said that they're going to start offering the UL seal of approval. Now, the UL seal of approval is, in fact, the product liability insurance policy. So they see the deeming and the upcoming regs as something for them to profit from, and they will. So that's an interesting twist on that. you know, as far as where this industry is going to go, I don't know. Vape shops are closing right and left. I'm watching old standards in this industry. We go to take a look at them. Let's count them, you know. 4 years ago, 3 years ago, who were the biggest online retailers 3 years ago?
3 years ago?
Years ago. Electronic Sticks? Right?
Yeah.
Electronicsticks.com. Gone. Okay. He sold the business. It's no longer online.
Okay. Yeah.
Gone. Clouds of Vapor? Gone. Is VapeRev gone, Keith? I don't think they're gone. Maybe they shut some brick and mortars down, but I don't know if they're gone from online. Vapor Craze had 11 stores. They're down to 2. It goes on and on. Remember Good Profits? Rob from Good Profits?
Mm-hmm.
He's gone. Steam Monkey, he had a good little business going. He's gone. E-Pipe Mods, they're still there, but, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who is still online? VapeRev, yeah. But ProVape is gone. All Smoke is gone. iVape is gone. Clouds of Vapor is gone.
Pure Smoker.
Pure Smoker, gone. Who else?
Yeah, you know, iVape.
Yeah. It just goes on and on and on and on. And these were the dealers that ran. I think Value Vapor is gone too. I can vape.
Yeah.
House of, I think HOV is still there.
Yeah. Plume Room is still there.
Plume Room is still there. Yeah. But again, you know, so many of the ones that were the staples, they're gone. You know, they just went away. And you walk into a brick and mortar store, and you can't. They all, and you know what? Every time I say this online, they fight with me. But I'm going to say it anyway. You know, they don't have starter kits. And then they said, yeah, we give away starter kits every day in our store to anybody and any smokers that come in. You know, dude, you haven't had a smoker walk in your store in years, right? They walk in, they see what's going on there, they turn around, they leave, you know?
Yeah.
You got,
well, it's
thugs.
Intimidating.
You got thugs. All Smoke is still, yeah, I thought so. But you got thugs behind the counter, you know? They blow clouds in your face, you know? I'd like to quit smoking. Dude, let me hook you up with this gnarly rig, you know. Sorry. You know, that's not good. We all wanted vape shops to happen locally, and then they open and then they don't sell products to quit smoking. They sell products to sell the vapors.
Mm-hmm.
And that just doesn't work, you know. That just doesn't work. And yeah, the eye care is not the answer, and start them off with a TFV12, you know. But I'll tell you what, I got really discouraged when I saw all of the posts when ProVape announced, all the posts saying, yeah, they failed because. And the fact is, they didn't fail at all. They shut down because it was time to shut down. So, and yeah, what did happen to converting smokers? You know, right now, you want to convert a smoker. The best place to do that is a gas station, and that's true. And that's a shame. But
yeah.
and that's the thing. Following my line of thought, don't cry for the owners of ProVape. They're fine. They have lovely homes. They're retired. They're going to enjoy their life. They're great, and they're great people, and they freaking deserve it. Okay, cry for the smokers that are smoking today. That will never get to experience this, you know?
Yeah.
And that's the tragedy, you know? Now, my argument against that is, you know what? All you need is a great tank and a great juice, and you can put it on virtually any mod, and you're good to go. And that's very, very true, but they will never have the reliability and the peace of mind that came from a piece that was as reliable as the ProVape products. I personally own over 1,000 mods. I collect mods. I have a lovely mod collection of e-pipes and old school mods. I really stopped collecting mods once the Stabwood craze came in, and none of that stuff was interesting to me. But I'm going to tell you something interesting about my mod collection. And by the way, I mean, I can just, here, look, I can do this, and I can reach down here. Look, there's a rare ZNA. Look, there's one of those. Look, here's the gold ProVary from back in 2011. Here's an Empire mod. You know, I can rattle this stuff all day long. There are literally dozens and dozens of mods on my desk here. And there's about 500 over there, and there's a couple hundred over there, and there's a couple hundred over there, and there's a couple hundred over in the museum at the store. But here's the thing, and this is a really important thing. I own over 125 ProVaries. I've been meaning to count them ever since yesterday, and I didn't. I own over 125 ProVaries. I have one of every color and size of anything that they made in version 1, version 2.5, version 2, version 3. I've got some of the classics. I've got two of the Proceons. I've got all of the radiuses that weren't the custom shop radiuses. I've got them all. And 100% of the ProVape products that I own all work. Okay? Every one of those 125 plus mods is functional. If I put a battery in it and put an atomizer on it, it works. And that's whether it was made in 2010 or whether it was made a few months ago. Every last one of them works without fail. And every one of them has always worked. And I have owned in my life over 200 ProVapes. Some, you know, I get duplicates, I sell them off. When I find a better one of that version, I'll sell the other one so somebody else can have it. I've owned over 200. I have only ever had one that had a problem, and it really didn't have a problem. It just, it had a symptom that I was able to fix without sending it in for service. So I've never sent one in for service. That's an amazing track record. Do you agree?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's an amazing track record. If I go to the rest of my mods, the other 1,000 of them, 70% of them don't work. Some of which worked when I got them. I put them on the shelf. I got them back out to play with them again one day, and they didn't work anymore. They just failed sitting there. Okay? No one, including myself, had the service record of ProVape. No one. And no one even came close. And I like to think I, you know, we do a pretty good job. But no one even came close. Less than one half of 1% of the products that they made ever came in for service. Think about it. Less than one half of 1%. Right? If GM had that, everyone would get bonuses and people would still want to buy American cars.
I understand that. I understand that.
One half of 1%, that's unheard of. You know, it's crazy. Keith, or Jeff, there it is. Ooh, we going unicorn hunting. Anyway, the China devices are junk. You know, they're garbage.
Yeah,
and much of the American-made stuff is garbage. You know, I mean, it's truly going to be, you know, amazing to see, you know, if anybody will ever come up in this industry and have a track record like ProVape had. Yet there's people out there, I'll call them what they are, they're assholes. There's people out there that go out there and badmouth that company, an American company, with a stellar service record, and they bash that company because they didn't make devices for people to blow clouds. You gotta be an asshole to do that. You really do. You really do. It's actually, you know what, Ginny, this is not a 50 cal. It's modeled after a 50 cal. and we scaled it down so that it was pocketable. But it's a unicorn slug. If you're gonna shoot unicorns, you need one. Hey, you know, if you're gonna hunt vampires, you need silver bullets. If you're gonna hunt
vampires, werewolves.
Werewolves. Okay, yeah, you need that. if you want to hunt these, you need
vampires. You cut their heads off.
Okay, whatever. Steaks, wood steaks, whatever. So, anyway, I tried to save ProVape. I tried to buy it. I tried to raise the money, and we just couldn't. We couldn't get it together. Nobody would. We couldn't get past the regulations, and that's we couldn't get past the regulations. And, you know, that is a sad day for House of Hybrids. It really is. Because we've got a lot of catch up to do because ProVape was a point of exit, a point of export. And for us, that one company had us for sale in shops in 168 countries. That's gonna be tough to overcome, but yeah, and yeah, Mondo. Lots of people posted that the ProVary was an overpriced piece of crap, and it's not. It simply isn't. I mean, you know, all somebody says when they say the ProVary was an overpriced piece of crap. What they're really saying is, I'm an ignoramus that doesn't know shit. That's what they're saying. Or, Howard, maybe they did own one, but they couldn't appreciate the quality, okay? Because that happens, you know, that does happen. People sometimes own the thing and they want it to do something that it can't do.
Yeah.
If you buy, let me tell you what, there are plenty of things that you can buy that are phenomenal things, but they can't do the thing that you want to do with it, you know? That's okay. That happens. People will buy things that are great in their own realm, but you know, it won't do certain things. You know, let's say you want to run the Indy 500, okay? You know, the Ford Focus is a great car. It's a phenomenal car, right? And it's spectacular for a family car, but you cannot use it in the Indianapolis 500. It's inappropriate, you know? It's, you know, that's what we're dealing with. We're dealing with people that can't see that. We're dealing with people that if the speedometer goes to 150, I want to go to 150. You know, you know, and I want to do it every day, constantly. You know? But we have a weird sense of value in this country, and that's just the way it is. You know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think everybody's just gotten so used to everything being crap and being replaceable, and you should just replace everything. You know, I think everyone's just gotten trained that this is the way it is. You know, I mean, we've lost our sense of quality because everything's convenient and everything is replaceable, you know? And that's just kind of what we expect now, you know?
But how do you call the one thing that doesn't break overpriced crap? You know, you can call it expensive. I don't have any problem with that. You know, I get that. You can say, when somebody says something is expensive, what they're really saying is I lack the means to afford it.
Yeah.
Okay. Guess what? You know.
I mean, like the Bugatti. I can't afford a Bugatti, but I'm not going to call it an overpriced piece of crap because I've actually seen like what goes into making these cars.
Right.
It's like, whoa.
I mean, you know, guess what? Most people can't afford this either. Okay, but that doesn't make it overpriced.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it means that it's out of your realm, you know. But people would rather make themselves feel good by calling something that's expensive overpriced than admitting that they can't afford it.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, Jen makes the comment, if you're broke, you should look for the reliable thing. But no, they look for the cheap thing, the thing that satisfies the urge. Okay. And let's not forget, if we were still using the smoker paradigm, which we really shouldn't, but in this case, but if we were still using the smoker paradigm, how many people walked into a gas station every day and paid top dollar for a pack of cigarettes because they didn't have the money to buy a carton, right? And ended up overpaying for their cigarettes daily, okay? Because they couldn't save up enough money to buy a damn carton every week, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's that people don't think like that. You know, it's like, I need cigarettes today.
Is that Brimless?
And I'll worry about tomorrow. Hey, Brim. Jamal, I saw all your messages coming in, but I'm kind of on the fucking show right now, so I couldn't respond.
Jamal, did you bring your clipboard?
Did he bring his clipboard?
Yes. Did he bring his clipboard?
So Jamal, I just want to mention something to you quickly. You mentioned doing an unboxing of some other device, and when you do that, just open it carefully because the instructions are on the inside of the box. Okay. So there you go. Be careful when you open it. So. What do you mean one got trashed? So how is what expensive? Well, you know what? It's not when you look at it that way. But they don't look at it that way, Jen. They look at it in the form of, I can go buy a 300-watt mod for $50. So why would I want to pay $200 for one that's only 30 watts? That's how they look at it.
But some people have to save up for that too. They don't have $200 or to drop on it, you know. And if they do have $200, then you know they probably need to buy other things too. So I mean, and whoever said the instant gratification is right. You know, it's like I need a mod so I can get this $50 one, or I can save up and get this $200 one. You know.
Yeah, so that's kind of what's going on there, but again, they don't really understand value. They mm-hmm. just understand, you know, getting something right now to satisfy the urge right now. You know.
Well, because going back to the carton of cigarettes example, you know, I could probably count on my hands how many times I actually bought an actual whole carton of cigarettes. You know, because I didn't have that much money right then, but I could scrape together a couple bucks every day to buy a pack of cigarettes, you know, back when they were only a couple of dollars. Now I probably would invest in cartons if I were still smoking. But I didn't have, was it $40? How much were cartons of cigarettes? $25 or $30?
I can't compare to your state because I live in New York State. Okay.
Yeah.
And when I quit smoking, smokes were about $9 a pack. And if you bought a carton, it was $72. Okay. Now, unless I went and bought the cigarettes from the Indian reservation, in which case it was $2.50 a pack or something like that. And $20 a carton. But here, you know why I didn't buy cartons for one reason. I didn't buy cartons for one reason, and that was because I liked the place that I stopped to get them on the way to work. And I would stop there, I'd get a cup of coffee, a candy bar, a pack of cigarettes. It was like part of my daily routine, right? And the other thing is, doing it that way to me was an understandable luxury that I enjoyed, okay? It wasn't that I was being lazy. It wasn't that I couldn't save up the money to buy a carton. I could have bought 100 cartons. It didn't matter. I was going to stop there anyway.
Yeah.
And by the way, when you buy a new pack every day, you know, you always have fresh cigarettes, right?
Yeah.
If you buy a carton, You know, on the 10th day, you know, they're 10 days old. This is how we lie to ourselves and make ourselves feel important. I wasn't a carton buyer, you know. Every pack was going to be my last for a long time, too.
Yeah.
You know, for years.
My last pack used to sit up here, and I don't know if it just got moved or what I did with it, but it used to sit right up here on my desk, and it sat there for a longest time, but I don't know what happened to it. Maybe it just got pushed to the back. I don't know.
You know, I used to, for a very long time, I smoked Cool Straights, no filter, and then I quit for a number of years, and then I got back into it, and I was smoking Camel menthols because
Darrell.
Hey Darrell. Yeah, and you're right, a drag of a cold menthol was the best. But what am I trying to say? I lost my train of thought. Guess it didn't much matter. Oh, I know. I was smoking smoking camel menthols, and you know, they used to come with those camel bucks, right? And so you would save those up, and then you could redeem them for things, right? And I mean, I remember one Christmas when I was like dead broke, you know, which was amazing. I could afford to smoke, but I was dead broke. And my son was in the Scouts, and I got him a really cool pocket knife from Camel, for a, and it was like a beautiful case knife, with $100-some-odd knife that I got using those Camel Bucks coupons, right?
Oh, it I got was, a bunch of shit from Marlboro.
Yeah, yeah, and the thing is, I used to kid people because I had this big glass jar that I would throw the Camel Bucks in. It was getting full, more and more and more full, and I would take them all down to Bike Week because they had a redemption tent at Bike Week. You could walk in, give them the coupons, and walk out with stuff. Everybody said, what are you trying to do there? You know, what are you saving those things for? Because there'd be hundreds and hundreds of them in there. And I would say, yeah, I'm saving up for an iron along.
In Australia, a pack of cigarettes is $40. Really?
No.
That's insane. Holy crap.
I don't even see where you're reading that.
It just went up. A lot of people typed.
We go.
Yeah, Joanne just said that. Holy crap. Wow.
Yeah, 40 a pack. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Oh, listen, there was a time when you could get if you managed to save up 100,000 or 200,000 of those freaking coupons, you could actually get a car, you know?
That's so a lot what of happened fucking smoking people, right there.
Well, no, but people in neighborhoods would pool their coupons, you know? You know, and it would they would be like, hey, listen, if you're not gonna do anything with the coupons, give them to me. So they'd get everybody in the neighborhood giving you their coupons, you know.
I remember I used to if I saw like a pack of cigarettes, you know how people leave like their empty packs on like the ashtrays and stuff, I would steal the miles from
them. Sure. Absolutely. Now, was it the FDA that said you can no longer include those coupons, I wonder?
I don't know, but yeah, I used to do the Marble Miles. I got a lot of fun camping gear, and I don't even camp, but I was just like, fuck it, why not? And I think Virginia Slims had where you could get some shit, too, from them by collecting the little coupon things.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
But the smoker's paradigm is so different, you know. You know, they spend a lot of money. They spend a lot of money, one day at a time, you know.
Mm-hmm. Full and, down mountain bike. What?
Yeah, that's serious. What'd you have? 100,000 of them?
Seriously, how much did you smoke? Holy shit!
Oh man.
No, I smoked Virginia Slims. For one reason only, okay? I smoked them because guys wouldn't touch them. And so, like, if you're out in, like, a smoking area, it like at my work or where at my school, especially my school when I was in college, the little smoking area, guys just like to hang out there. I don't know why, but it was mostly just dudes, all right? And so if you have a pack of Virginia Slims or what were those one Eves or the Capris, you know, the little fucking mini cigarette things that they used to have.
Oh, sure.
And the ones that were colored, I can't remember, they were like red and blue. They had all these like pastel colors. I can't remember what the name brand of those were.
I remember those and they were beautiful.
Yeah, but guys wouldn't come near you. They were just like, oh, you smoke those and I ain't smoking that, you know, because it's a girl cigarette, you know. So I smoked Misty. Is that what they were, Misty's? No,
yes.
I never smoked the Moors. I never smoked Moors, but yeah, I smoked Virginia Slims and Capris and the fucking girly cigarettes because I, you know, if you walk into a smoking area, like, oh, you gotta smoke, can I have one of those? You know, and they would just try to bum the shit out of them, but they knew you smoked Virginia Slims. They didn't want anything to do with you. So.
Because that would make them gay.
Yeah, with the gold filters. They had gold and then they were like pastel colors, like pink,
the Moors,
blue. The Moors were brown.
They were brown.
Yeah.
Somebody made a black cigarette.
Oh, I don't know.
I think
Capris had the butterflies and shit on them. Yeah. And they were like little tiny. They were little. They looked like coffee stirrers because they were little tiny, tiny little. They weren't big like a cigarette. They were like a coffee stirrer, like if you have a straw and a coffee stirrer. Yeah, Capris were like really tiny fucking little cigarettes. They looked cool though when you're smoking them. They were about as big around as like a candy cigarette, but yeah, I don't know who the ones that were the colors, all the different colors.
Keith, there were black cloves, but there were also Nat Sherman's. Howard got it. Nat Sherman's had a black cigarette. Black with a gold filter. And Nat Sherman's also had them in multiple colors as well. Nat Sherman's were great cigarettes.
I smoked Virginia Slim 120s.
The Jarums. Oh my God.
Gloves.
Well, for a long time I smoked Cool Streets and the only place to get them was to drive to the ghetto.
Virginia Slim 120 menthol.
Nobody in the burbs, nobody in the suburbs carried cool filterless. And so I had to drive up to, ready? Avenue D. Had to go to Avenue D. The corner of Avenue D and Conkey Avenue. Nat Sherman's Fantasias, they were great. They were great. It was a beautiful cigarette from a high-end tobacconist too. That was a fine cigarette. It's a fine cigarette to this day. And but anyway, as we talk about cigarettes, we're talking about the economy of cigarettes. You know, there's all these choices. There's all this marketing that gets you in. Some are shorter, some are longer, some are thinner, some are browner, some are colored, some have got little butterflies on them. You know, and off you go. You know, and you know, I was a menthol smoker. I knew what I liked. And I enjoyed the fuck out of them, right? I liked smoking. I really did. But you know, there comes a point where you're an adult, you grow up, you say it's time to not do this anymore. You discover e-cigs, and now the FDA wants to let us have them on their terms. I don't view the FDA as saying they're taking them away. I view the FDA as saying you can have them on our terms. And, you know, yes, there's going to be a moment of shock in all of that, you know, there is that. But whatever we end up with, we'll get the job done on some level, because people don't need to blow clouds to quit smoking. And that's the point.
Mm-hmm.
If the Juul gets to stay in the market, everything's fine. If the MyJet gets to stay in the market, the iCare, these things, people will be able to quit smoking. The hobby of vaping will be done. It'll be over, right? Mm-hmm. It'll go underground. It'll shrink. There won't be any way to, you know, it just won't make any sense. But, you know, it's just the way it was. And hey, guess what?
I liked pipes too. Yeah.
Pipes are great. Boy, do I have some cool pipes.
Oh, I bet. I wouldn't doubt it.
But it's all good. And
I love how they smell.
Yeah. But if we get the whole, they're not taking vaping away entirely. They're changing it. Okay. And it's going to change into something that's good to get the job done, to get people to quit smoking.
Well, we're seeing how this country reacts to change.
I'm going to go out on a limb here. And I'm going to say some controversial shit. Can I say some controversial shit?
Please do.
All right. I got into the vaping industry because I wanted to help people quit smoking.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Not because I wanted to get rich. I was already doing just fine. Right? Not because I wanted to make more money. I'm okay. Right? I got into it because I saw an opportunity to help people. And if the FDA comes along and says, Mike, you can't help people anymore, I step back and I say, well, who's going to help these people? And I look and see what they're going to allow in the market, which will be cigarette-like things that are so much better now than they used to be. And they're going to be jewel sticks and this stick and that stick, you know. And I look at it and say, okay, I'm fine with that. I don't care if I'm in the vaping industry. I care if there's an e-cig industry that can help people quit smoking. If every last one of the mod makers in this country falls and we can have something like a Juul or a Sync or a MyJet or a Vonerol, and that means that people can quit smoking, good. I'm fine with that. I'm perfectly fine.
I'm okay with that too, but I do think that because just coming from, you know, I did stop smoking using a product like that. And it's frustrating. And
yep.
It's, you know, because I think that they need to allow it to be refillable. It needs to be a refillable device if it's going to help people stop smoking, because the little cartridge things are bullshit. Yep. You know,
yeah,
so
but, I don't know. Have you tried the latest round of the Sync, like the Juul?
Yeah, but my point is that, you know, if people have a way to reuse the device instead of it all just being a disposable market, I think that that's like a better way to go, you know, and because it is very frustrating. So I think so anyway. And
enjoy.
No, I haven't used a Juul. I don't know what that is, but.
So the Juul will get the job done. Okay. And that's all I care about, you know.
But I don't want to see the world go back to 408s, you know.
No, or 808s.
Or 808s.
I don't want to see that either, but it's, I don't think it's going to. I think that in this paradigm, that the Juul, the Vonerol, all of these are going to exist, okay? And I'm okay with that. And they're coming from bigger companies that have the money to get through the PMTAs and that. Let it happen, you know. You know. This is going to hurt, but it's going to be all right, you know? And because my concern, you know, is that there's something here for the smokers, you know? This is my version of think about the children. There's something here for the smokers, you know? That's what I care about. I care that there's a pathway to get them off of cigarettes. And as long as stuff like this can exist, yes, it's expensive, but if you're truly motivated, you're going to quit smoking. Okay. And it's the way it was before. We were truly motivated when, you know, and we used 808s and 801s to quit smoking. If we could do it, so can other people. You know, the people that are saying I won't be able to have my 300 watt mod, so fuck the FDA, they're being selfish, you know. And their biggest fear is they know inherently that 300 watt mod is going to fail, you know. And one day they're going to wish, watch this amazing transition, Mel. This is great.
Okay.
One day they're going to wish they had a fucking ProVary.
Yeah.
Okay. Because when these things are no longer available because the FDA cracked down on them, and you can say, well, I still own one, when it breaks, you're going to wish you had this.
Yeah.
At that point, at that point, this suddenly makes more sense, because I guarantee you, if I used it every day, this is going to break.
Yeah.
And this is not. And that's the difference. And, you know, this is a fucking goner, right? This is not. And that company said, we got to get out of this business. It's time for us to retire. And I could not pull together an investor group that was risk tolerant enough to be able to make it happen. And it's sad for me, because when this goes away, so does that reliability. And sure as I'm standing here, vaping's going to make it so that if I had bought that company, one day they're going to tell me I can't make this anymore. And when that happens, I'm going to be glad that I have a cabinet full of ProVaries, you know? So there you go.
Vaping tourism.
Vaping tourism will become a growth UK industry. And you know what? I can see how you're only half joking. And guess what? Canadian tourism also.
Damn Canadians.
Hey, we went there to buy Cuban cigars. We can go there to buy vape gear.
Yeah.
You know, and we can go there to buy e-liquid, you know. And by the way, Canadian e-liquid is some of the best in the world.
Yep.
So.
I love my Canadian e-liquid.
So. Me too.
Heck yeah.
Vaping some right now. As long as your ZNA boards hold out. Yeah, well, you know, the problem is, you know, I can tell you this. The ZNA is a lovely PV. I made it, and I'm proud of it, but that board does not have the long-term reliability that I was promised. And that's sad. I can't guarantee you it's going to last forever. You know, I wish I could, but I can't guarantee it, you know. So...
I just put my juice in a chipstone bowl and drop hot rocks from the fire into it to make the beaker.
His version of vape dabbing.
Smoke opium. God, you remember the little charcoal things? Do they still have those? God, I haven't freaking been in any... scene for a long time, but yeah, remember those little charcoal things that you used to get, and you would like, and they would burn, you would light them and they would just burn like a cross, and then you would drop fucking like opium on them and shit.
What would you drop on them?
Like opium.
oh yes, I remember opium.
Now granted, I was just a witness, okay, you know, but yeah, back in the 80s when like all kinds of shit was going on, and I remember them because I always thought the charcoal things were really cool because it's the way that they burned, you know. But
I know the things you're talking about, and please, it's so simple, even a caveman. Oh, what are you looking at, a chipped rock bowl? Throw rocks from the fire. I think we'll do that at a summer party.
Oh, that's funny. Who wants to vape?
Ken, that's true. That is true. As long as you have a mech in your collection, you will be able to a mech and a rebuildable adder. You'll be able to vape. There's no question. That's true. And even then, I won't blow clouds. But. So anyway, geez, we just did an hour on the state of the vaping industry.
And you know, and there's going to be more that fall.
You know? Yeah, there most certainly
will. It's not going to be the last company that goes down, you know.
Well, I don't know if I'll be the last one standing. You know, it's like we're diversifying into other areas, you know.
Well, you've got the foreign markets though, so
I do have the foreign market, but it's difficult, you know.
Yeah.
Although you know, we went through the TPD process to be able to sell in the UK. Which is, you know, their version of the PMTA. The difference is it cost about $2,000 US. And it doesn't involve human studies. It wasn't a blank check for $500,000 or more. It was not traumatic at all. Okay. And it wasn't expensive, and at all of their regulations seemed to make sense to me, except for their 2 mil tank limitation, but whatever, you know. It's just, you know, it just is what it is. Very boring. Just said the world may end with Trog still putting out screwdrivers. And you know what? He's right. And you know what's sad is, yeah, there's a fair number of people in this chat here. But it's illegal in Australia, you know. The shit gets grabbed in customs. So shipping to Australia is risky as hell. But anyway, back to what Bowering said. The whole, you know, the screwdriver is a device that if you walk up to, I'll address that in a second, Joanne. If you walked up to a lot of the people that are vaping, you know, that have only been vaping, you know, in the modern era of vaping, they don't even know what Trog is. You know, it doesn't matter. But it is absolutely illegal. It is absolutely illegal for me to export my products to Australia. Positively. Absolutely illegal for me to do it. You know, you might live there, but I know what happens if I ship a package and customs seizes it. It's very expensive when it happens, and it happens a lot, not a little. So we have to sneak shit through customs, you know. So the other problem is it's not trackable in Australia once it gets past customs. So we get a lot of things disappearing once it hits customs. So, you know, what am I going to do? You know, what are you going to do? I love it that you say it's illegal in Australia, and somebody in Australia says no, it's not. It's like, well, then you don't know your own laws. You know, I'm the guy that's got to fill out the customs forms, and the customs forms say it's illegal. So. What are you gonna do?
Mm-hmm.
And I contact freight forwarders to try to. It is absolutely illegal in Australia and has been for. You know who might know? Knocked. You might know this. When did they? That guy in the Billion Lives movie that lost everything. When was that? That was what, a year and a half ago when that all changed. Knocked would know that. Better than I do. I've only seen the movie once. He's had to sit through it several times. But yeah, the laws have changed, and it is a real problem shipping into Australia. And I would love to do big business. Yeah, Vince. What about Vince? 2 years it's been. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway. There you go. But it is illegal and I can't ship there. And I wish I could, because I get calls for it all the time. And a lot of the people that call me say, yeah, it's illegal, but we can get it in. And then I say, well, if it gets seized, it's on you. And then they say, no, I don't want to place the order because they know it's going to get seized. They just try to make it be, I lose the money instead of them. But you know, yeah. So, whatever. So if you advocated for Vincent, then what is it? What were you advocating for? I don't understand what happened there then. I do know that I can't ship there, but I'm just curious. I'm just curious about, you know, if you advocated, then you know something went down there. What went down? This lag is a problem, you know, because you if I stop talking to wait for the
I can't do anything about it.
Yeah, no, I know. It's not your fault. It's them, but anyway, the lag makes it so that if I'm waiting for the chat, there's like 5 or 8 seconds of silence, you know, which doesn't make for a good show.
So yeah, so we'll just answer the questions as we see them. So, you know, feel free to kind of go back and forth, you know.
Yeah. Yep. So anyway, ProVape fell. Vermont Vapor's gone. He was falsely rated over selling products that looked like cigs and they were egos. Right. But how can you tell me then that it's not illegal? This is the part that I don't understand in this story. Falsely rated for selling products that looked like cigs and they were egos. But you say, but it's not illegal. I don't get it. What am I missing here? I'm missing something. Chris, it's because it's illegal. Well, yeah. Chris, had any luck shipping into Australia? It's you know, it's amazing with the lag. I could actually walk up the street to Chris's and ask him a question and come back quicker. Oh, we gotta find a way to slow the pace of the show down so this seems more natural.
I don't know how to do it.
So Chris's answer is no, he has not had any luck shipping into Australia. The law in Australia was written for candy that looked like cigarettes, and they used it to get him on ego devices. Uh-huh. Okay. Well, they somewhere along the line it's become illegal there because they absolutely seized this stuff in customs. Because the law that he was charged over was not meant to encompass E6. Well, it does now. Yeah. And even though it wasn't meant to encompass E6, he ultimately still lost. So, you know, they made the law mean what they wanted the law to mean. In memory of ProVape, that's this program. That's what this program is about. Tonight, in memory of ProVape. And when people start talking about ProVape being overpriced junk, I show you the ProVery 1, ProVery 2 actually, 24 karat gold plated. They came out this.
Nice.
Okay, now we're back to it's illegal in Western Australia. Okay. Back in, back when this came out, this was so outrageous for a company to do this, okay? And 24 karat gold plated. And they did it because a few people said, you should make a gold plated one. And they said, no, it'll never sell. You couldn't get one. They were so popular, you know. Every one they made, they sold. But overpriced junk. Well, guess what? Sometimes people want overpriced junk. This is an amazing device. It still works today. 24 karat gold plated ProVery. They didn't make a lot of them, but every one that they made sold, and it's exceedingly rare. So how about this? Want to see something cool?
Mm-hmm.
How about the only Zencoat Gold ProVery Dragon in existence? The Golden Dragon.
Ooh.
The Golden Dragon. One of them exists. There it is. How about that? How about that? Walk down memory lane. I remember getting this gold ProVary. Remember how Ripple always complained that he never wins contests?
Yeah.
He won this in a contest.
Nice.
And he complained that he never wins things in a contest after he won that. Because he never wins anything that he wants in a contest. So he had a gold ProVary and he traded it to me for some other stuff because he said it's too cool for him. I have the gold Dragon Genie. I had to buy it too. I have some pretty rare ProVaries here. I've got, I have the prototypes of every stealth that they ever did. The actual prototypes. I bought those. I have the prototype of the zombie. The actual first prototype of the zombie. It has a completely different end cap on it. It's really cool. So, let's see. Illegal in Australia unless the product is registered and approved under the Therapeutic Good Act, according to quit.org.au. Well, I'm special. I am special because I had a vendor relationship with them, and they did they made stuff available to me that nobody else could get, which was kind of cool. But you know, they one day they realized I had a better collection of ProVaries than they had, and yeah, the ripple effect. You both have Sakushis. Yeah. When they realized that I had a bigger collection of ProVaries than they actually had, they said that I should have their prototypes so that it was a complete collection, which was cool. They helped me get some stuff together so that I had as close to a complete collection. Let's have a little, this is not a contest where you win anything. You win this for bragging rights. And you're welcome to guess at the answer. You don't have to know because I don't think anybody does know. But the ProVary 2.5 came out in a lot of different colors through the years, starting with satin silver, and moving on to some other colors. But the question that I have to pose is as follows: How many different colors? Was the ProVary 2.5 available in, from start to finish? And yeah, I do, Jeannie, I do remember Darth Octane's GG Collector. That was insane. So anyway, start to finish, how many colors, including satin, silver, how many colors and variations of the 2.5 were there, and go? Keith says 33. Let's see if anybody else gets any answers. Huh, there's never been a Byzantium dragon. There should be though, shouldn't there? Yeah. Jen says six colors.
Two. I'm going with two.
Going with two. Silver and black.
Silver and black. Yeah.
Genie says 26. Brimless says 47. Very boring says many. Jen has no idea.
I'm going with silver and black, man. Silver and black.
I'm going to go with two. Silver and black.
Letting it ride.
Rose gold. There was never rose gold. Howard Petty says 40. Mondo Mendez says 20. Oh, the correct answer is 30. That was available in 30 colors and variations. So a complete collection of ProVary 2.5s is indeed 60 pieces. Well, I'm sorry, it is not 60 pieces. It's 30 colors, 60 minus 1, 2, 3, 2. 60 minus, so there were 58 variations. I'm not counting the LEDs, Sean. I'm talking about the actual numbers of colors. There were 30 different colors. And then there were mini and standards. Now there were two that were not available in standard length. There were two colors that were only available in mini. And the two colors that were only available in mini was pink to white fade and purple to white fade. That was only available in mini. But the, let's see if you can hear me, because I got to get up here and look at it. The colors are, let's see if I can see them from here. Black to white fade, red to black fade, blue to green fade, emerald green. There's that brighter green. I don't know what it's called. That brighter purple, the brighter fuchsia, the brighter pink. Then you got a glossy black. Then you've got Tiffany blue. Then you've got two versions of the zombie. Satin silver, polished. Then you've got white, blue, pink, purple, blue, old style polished. There's a emerald green, gold Zen coat, black Zen coat. What is that one? That one of. Let's see, polished dragon. That's it. Yeah, that's all of them. So let's see, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 15, 30. Yep, 30. Oh, no, you know what? It's 60 variants there, plus it's 62 variants. So anyway, Keith, good night. Brim was closest. You don't win anything, but it was cool. And then there was let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 variations of customs end caps that you could get through the years. That does not account for any of the many versions of the P3, which there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Now, there was probably 20 P3s because there's a few that I don't have. And then there was two versions of the V1, and the V2 had 6 versions. And the answer is... And the answer, somebody asked, how many of them do I have? The answer is all of them. I have a complete collection of 2.5s. There's a couple of version 2s that I don't have, and there's a few version 3s that I don't have. And I only have one classic. Because the classic was, I just never loved it. So I didn't buy into it. Although I suppose now I would probably want to try to find some, but... yeah, remember when it was fun to know, babe? It was. But, you know, for what it's worth, you know. So Joanne says, if that's so hard, that brick and mortars in Australia openly selling without getting raided and no threat of getting raided, quit. Well, you know, at the bottom line, I can't ship there. We got into this discussion about whether it's illegal or not. And it comes down to, it doesn't matter. I can't ship there. It gets seized. So... what can I do? You know, I wish I could ship there. People in Australia want my stuff. They call all the time. They say, please ship to me. And it's like, I just can't. I'll lose your shipment. It'll be gone. And yeah, sometimes stuff gets through. And Ali El Said has figured out a way to get stuff through for himself. But And I'm sure lots of people are getting stuff in there, but when something comes out of House of Hybrids, it gets seized. So what am I going to do? I wish your guys wouldn't do that to me. So anyway, so that's it. ProVary's gone. Who's next?
Yeah, who's next? Who's left?
Oh, let's talk a little bit about how that affects me beyond the stuff that we already discussed. As many people know that we had the ZNA Pro coming out that was going to use the ProVary board. Well, the ZNA Pro was sort of predicated on me being able to complete that deal to buy ProVape, wasn't it? You know, so I can't get boards when they're gone. So it's obviously not coming out. But we've been working on something else for the rest of the world. We're not supposed to launch it here in the U.S. after August 8th, so we really can't. However, a version of it did exist earlier under a different brand, so we might have a leg up in there. So be looking for some announcements in the next month about a new mod coming from us that's a complete about face from anything that we've ever done. Now, will it be available in this country or not? That remains to be seen, because there are laws that I do follow. So we'll see what happens there. We have taken some steps that I believe are useful and important for our survival. So I'm going to talk about those now. Can we talk about those, Mel?
Yeah.
You want to talk about those? I'm doing all the talking tonight, aren't I?
That's fine. You get it out. Right. Get it out.
Get it
out. Therapeutic.
And Jamal can actually tell you, and Jeff knows about this, and a few other people in here know about this. Sean knows about it. Let's talk about what I've got coming, okay?
Okay.
And let's talk about why I'm doing it, okay? As long as I live, and by the way, in about 16 days, that will be 60 years that I've been on this fucking rock floating in space. And in this 60 years, if you had said to me, even 10 years ago, the day would come when nicotine is being regulated and marijuana is legal, I would have bet against you in a heartbeat. Okay?
Uh-huh.
And I would have been wrong. I would have been wrong. I'm seeing, you know, more and more states, you know, this November, more states are going to pass recreational, and many states have got medical. I think that it's foolish to have the facility that I have and not be manufacturing something for the medical marijuana and recreational.
I'm surprised it took you this long.
it took me this long because I didn't know the direction I wanted to go in this industry, but with the help of a lot of my younger employees and urging from people that are smart people that, you know, said you could really make a splash in that market, I said, okay, we'll take a step into it. So we have come out with, and it actually launches officially Monday, a wax concentrate atomizer. And we did a pre-sale, and some people in this thread actually have them. This thing is going to be a big success. I really believe it. It's going to be a very, very big success. And I'm going to tell you two reasons why I went into it. Number one is we don't know that we can sustain ourselves on the vape industry now that ProVape is gone.
Mm-hmm.
This is a necessity of business at this point. We don't believe that we can sustain ourselves on the vape industry alone in this country. And now that we've lost our biggest worldwide distributor, we only see red ink. So last year, our business lost just a little over $250,000. And that means that you have to have that $250,000 to lose it. And we did, and it's gone. So that's not good. That's not good. But we have skills and we have engineering capabilities and we have marketing teams, and we can produce a device that will make a significant impact in that market. And we've designed it. It's called the Rakeku.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful device.
It is. It looks really nice.
And so far, I'll talk about that in a minute, Sean. And so far, the feedback has been good and solid. The early people in with it are loving it. And now, the more people that get it, that we increase the likelihood of somebody saying they don't like it. But so far, it's all positive. But this opens a door for us, which is good, because there are CBD liquids and oils that can be used in a kabuki, okay, first of all, with proper dilutants and such. And, you know, this gives us an alternative market for a device that we already have, and an alternate device for a market that we weren't in. And the other thing is, as long as, you know, it's very interesting to me, but when push comes to shove, if we keep on making this stuff, we can be making it for that other market, and e-cig people can buy the products that would work with liquids. So we can continue to make devices for that we'll be able to use with e-liquids or diluted CBDs and diluted oils, you know, active oils. So this keeps us going. This will keep us in business. And as much as I didn't love the idea of going into the market, and for years and years in the e-cig market, we tried to distance ourselves from the head shop market and the tobacco shop market. That was foolish, and that's where we need to be heading. So we are heading there. Sean asked about the QDC. What's that interchangeable with? They also make a ceramic coil that we don't care much for, but Chris is going to be carrying those in stock because some people do like them. He's also got another alternative coil that's coming, which is a vertical single coil. And we're also looking. We're also looking at manufacturing coils in this country at some point. So it's not that we're absolutely going to, but we're looking into it. And yes, we've had to adapt, and we've had to find a way to keep this going. But I'm encouraged. We're full steam ahead on this thing, and I'm excited for it. As Jen said, those people clearly know how to get legislation. Yeah. Starts by not being assholes, okay? Starts by not getting in people's faces and blowing clouds at them. Starts by not, by being cool. And that's the big thing is the cannabinoid market did a very, very good job of simply being chill, okay?
That's because they're all stoned.
Yeah, but they're chill. I mean, you know, we see them saying,
they just want to eat chips. That's, they don't have time to be assholes because they're stoned and they're hungry. So,
Brim, I don't intend on making a rebuild deck for anything ever. Okay. It's just not on my radar. I want devices to be easy to use. I don't want to encourage hobbyist behaviors. I want convenience. And there you go. You know, we're just not going to go to the rebuildable deck. So the guys in the cannabinoid market were chill and laid back, and they hired lobbyists to get done what needed to get done, and they created a political party, and on and on and on and on. They did it right. They were mellow. the vaping industry became, frankly, if you go to the average person that doesn't vape and say, tell me your impression of a vapor, they're going to say it's a thug, a punk, guys blowing clouds in my face, blah, 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 blah. And, you know, they weren't chill. They were not chill at all. The vapors didn't do it right. And as you know, I screamed it from the mountaintop. I really did. And they told me to shut the fuck up.
No dumb home. That's right.
Good night, Jen.
Night, Jen.
You know,
thanks
and that's
for coming
the thing.
And hanging out with us.
They told me to shut the fuck up. I said, don't do that. It's going to draw too much attention. They said, get off my lawn. You know, how is that helpful? You know, you old fuck, what are you doing? You're ruining our fun. No, you're ruining my business. I'm not ruining your fun. You're ruining my business. And, you know, now everybody wants to say they're for advocacy. Everybody's saying, well, what about the smokers? Everybody's saying all the things. They want to be heard saying those things while they're lining their pockets, pandering to cloud blowers, because those guys blow through e-liquid, and boy, do those guys protect their e-liquid margins. You know, those guys have got obscene margins, and they protect them like it's damn near price fixing. You know, well, guess what? Quitting smoking ain't supposed to be fun. Oh my God, Knox just posted that as I said it. Whoa. Wow. Krista had her baby 6 pounds, 3 ounces. All right, so put that in the oven at 350. Put that
congrats
in the oven at 350 for about 40
like
minutes
baby.
A pound. And it'll stuff
like
it.
Babies.
What? What?
I said I like babies.
Oh, okay. I was giving him a recipe.
I have a story kind of related to that, but I'm not going to tell it. So.
Does it do any tricks? Oh, man. Oh. What do you think, Mal?
About what? About all of this?
All of it.
I don't know. I'm just watching it all burn to the fucking ground, and it's not really much that can be done about it. So,
I mean, you flew all over the country in the name of advocacy. What'd you see?
Like, honestly?
Yeah, be honest.
Honestly,
come on. No,
I'm amazed, okay, at the response of vapers to advocacy. I'm amazed that, you know, so many people really do want to get involved, and I applaud everyone's efforts in that. But on the other hand, I'm amazed at how many people know so little about our government and the way that our government works. And,
Isn't it crazy?
And you know, Knox in here, and Joanne's in here, and Brimless, and you, and Mondo, and you know, and half the people in here that are talking are advocates, you know, for in one way or another for the vaping industry. And people have been screaming from the rooftops on how our government works and how you need to get involved. And I don't know if people just forgot how our government works. Or if they didn't know in the first place, or if they just kind of smiled and nodded. I don't understand how vapers of all people do not understand how all this shit works, you know, and what options
they
do have, you know, and what, you know, it's mind boggling to me, you know, and I don't know.
There's been a common.
Is it a lost cause? No, I don't feel that it's a lost cause at this point. You know, it might be my Pollyanna positivity that is, you know, causing me, but I don't think that the vaping industry is a lost cause. You know, and I do think that it's worth fighting for, and I do think that, you know, things can change. You know, so I don't know. I just think I don't know what I think, but I don't think that we're lost, you know. I don't think that it's all gone, you know.
I do.
Well, I do.
I don't think
that it's right that we should be able to smoke pot but not nicotine, especially when nicotine is not an illegal substance. You know, I mean,
I think that making
all of our young adults infants is a wrong thing to do. I think that raising the age to smoking to 21 is a wrong thing to do. I think that our government needs to be called. It needs to just stop and realize that it's fucking stupid, and that none of this shit is even makes remotely any fucking sense. It doesn't make any sense to me, you know. I mean,
Lisa made a comment. I'm amazed so many people sat on their damn asses up until now. Lisa, they're still sitting on their damn asses, but they've learned what to say that makes it look like they're not sitting on their asses, and that's the thing. They're like magpies out there repeating things that they've read that makes it appear as though they care. And the only thing that they care about is now that they see it going away, now they're going to say, get out and advocate. But they're not getting out and advocating themselves. Okay? It's still denial and accident.
They're making
the noises as though they're doing something about it, and they're the same people over and over and over again that are doing all of the heavy lifting. And then let's face it, even in the industry where there's advocates, they're out there advocating, saying one thing, and back in the shops that they do, that they own, they're doing something entirely different. And without naming names, and Chris knows exactly who I'm talking about, okay, because I'm not going to name names on this because it's his business, okay, but without naming names, on one hand, over here you have a guy who's an advocate who's screaming childproof caps, childproof caps, childproof caps, childproof caps, and over here in a vape shop that he owns, he's buying specifically bottles without childproof caps, okay, to give to his customers so that they can remove the childproof caps and put the liquid into bottles that don't have childproof caps. So this is called creating the appearance that you're doing something about it while at the same time undoing everything that you preached. And that's fucking terrible, okay? The same advocates will get in your face and say, you're not doing it right, you're not doing it right, you're not doing it right. They go right back to their own shops and don't do it right. And Chris is saying I'm not wrong because he knows exactly who and what I'm talking about, okay? These are our advocates that are out there advocating, as they do. What they're doing is they're flapping their mouth, okay? They're flapping their mouth, flapping their mouth, flapping their mouth, okay? Crazy. Craziness. And then they go back and do something different. Brimless, what about that smoker in Vegas at that event? That smoker became the president of a vaping company. He's no longer there, by the way, but he became the president of a vaping company. Okay. Guy standing at Vape Fest at a table smoking a cigarette indoors at a vape event. It was insanity. It was insanity. Of course, he's no longer in the industry, but for a while, he had a pretty high position in the industry, you know. So, the problem is, Lisa, you said they sat on their asses up until now. They're still on their asses. They are still on their asses, and they will be on their asses until it's all gone. Until it's done. And And, you know, but they're going to do everything in their power to make it look to their customers and only to their customers like they're doing something about it. You know, it's crazy. And Lisa brings up a point, bottles without certified caps. Okay. You know, you had to have the bottle certs. You got to have all the documentation for that. It got to be done by a certain date. Everything's got to get done. Got to do this. You better do this or else your business is going to be in a shambles over it and blah, blah, blah. Everybody did it. Nobody's getting busted for it. Nobody, you know, and you know, what are you going to do? What you going to do? It comes down to, as long as these people have the formula to look like they're doing something about it, that's all that matters. It's the appearance that they're working on advocacy, not the actual advocacy work itself that counts to them.
Well, I think it's fallen back on the wayside of all of the other issues that are present in our climate today, our political climate. So I think that people still care about vaping, but it's not as important as these other things that are happening, you know? So, I don't know. I might be wrong about that. I mean, I'm sure to some people, vaping is still the number one, you know, issue on their mind, you know, but I think that for a lot of vapers, they would rather scream about DeVos or cry about Trump or talk about whatever, you know, issue is currently on their minds, you know, instead, you know, and it's, I might be wrong about that, but, you know, I mean, just looking through my Facebook feed.
Oh.
You know.
You know.
People aren't talking about vaping, you know.
Listen, after the election, okay, I knew that there was going to be upheaval, you know, no matter who won, okay. If Clinton had won, people on one side were going to be wrong. You're going to be angry, and if Trump won, people on the other side are going to be angry. That's going to happen. That shit usually calms down right around by inauguration day. Okay. This one is just going on and on and on and on and on, and they're looking more and more and more foolish. Yeah. It's just this on and on it goes. And it's just, you know, where it stops, I know. It stops when somebody, you know, something bad happens. And this needs to stop. I mean, you know, the division of this country. I've talked to people that said, nobody gave Obama a chance. They're not going to give Trump a chance. I'm like,
who fucking cares? The discussions, I'm not calling them arguments because I like to have discussions, but you know, I hear the, well, what about Christians? Well, what the fuck about them? Well, you know, 10 million years ago we had crusades and they killed a bunch of people. It was fucking 5,000 fucking years ago. Jesus Christ, yeah. Get over it. What's happening right now, you know?
10 million years ago.
10 million years ago that shit happened, but you know, well, what about the Indians? We killed a bunch of Indians. And it's like, yeah. And I was mean to a girl in fourth grade because she had a fucking, she used to piss me off. She thought she was fucking Pat Benatar. Okay. But she was fat. All right. Now I don't have a problem with fat people because I'm fat myself. You know,
Did you call her Pat Benatar? Yes, I did.
Okay.
You called her Pat Benatar?
Yes. You know,
way to go, girly.
And so, because I loved Pat Benatar, she was the coolest fucking thing ever, you know, back in fucking sixth grade or whatever. Okay. So anyway, so she used to piss me off because she used to fucking try to dress like her, except she looked like a sausage more than Pat Benatar, you know? And so, and I'm not talking like uniform, you know, custom, you know, a commercially made sausage. No, I'm talking about like first try at the sausage machine because you don't know what the fuck you're doing, sausage, okay? And so she made me mad, okay? For whatever reason, this just pissed me off so bad, okay? And because yeah, I was fat when I was little too, you know, but I would never dress in a way that made me look like, you know, a back alley sausage. Okay, so anyway,
back alley sausage.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. You've been to Vegas. You know the hookers that you find in the back alleys. Okay.
Yeah, they're
not the refined, nice looking ones that they shove in front of the casinos. Oh no. No. You know.
They're those other ones.
They're the $20 ones. Okay?
Yeah. Those are the good ones though. They try really hard.
Anyway.
Taffy.
There we go. Taffy. Okay.
Chris, you spelled it wrong. It's T-A-P-H-I-E.
Oh. Fancy. She's a fancy anal hooker. Anyway. So, but I'm like, I was mean to this girl in the fourth grade because she pissed me off. For whatever reason, she just pissed me off, okay? And so, do I feel bad? Yeah, I probably shouldn't have picked on her. But I was in the fucking, sixth grade or whatever. I don't owe her a house. I don't have to buy her a house because I called her Fat Benatar, okay? And I was mean to her, you know? I don't owe her anything. You know, so it's the same fucking thing. You know her real name? Jesus Christ.
I just made that up, but I liked it. Laquisha.
I'm like, my God, how much time did you all spend with Taffy? Anyway, so, you know, and I'm not going to get into my discussions this week. But I am having my monologues. And I am still continuing with that. And I'm having a lot of great conversations about a lot of interesting topics. So if you have liberal friends that you are just sick of listening to, send them my way. Be like, hey, I got this chick that you should talk to. Seriously.
Yeah.
Make my day.
And it's funny, you know, as I went looking online, I found articles from other people that feel the same way you do. And, you know.
Well, I want to talk about these. I want to talk about this stuff. I don't want to scream. I don't want to, you know, fill my timeline with memes. And I don't, you know, I want to know what, I want to understand where, you know, and I think that discussion is the way to go, you know, because, you know, I had a very long discussion about Elizabeth Warren today and, you know, her plight with the fucking Senate or whatever you want to call her, you know, when the Senate just bitch slapped her and told her to shut the fuck up, you know. So I had a great conversation about that, you know. So.
Yeah. Well.
I don't know what people are calling me, and I don't know if I'm being blocked because no one's actually rage quit on me yet. So I don't know if I'm being blocked. I don't know if I'm being, you know, if people are like just wanting to stab me in the face because no one's really telling me that they want to do that stuff. So I don't know, but I'm sure I have been.
And that's the problem is these guys can't even properly rage quit anymore. You know, it's, you never know when you've really hit the mark until they rage quit.
Yeah. And no one's rage quit on me yet. They keep coming back and wanting to talk to me. And I'm like, cool, let's fucking talk then. You know, let's have a conversation. A
couple things I want to hit before we get out of there. Super Bowl.
Oh my God. Go ahead.
Super Bowl. The body shaming of directed towards Lady Gaga. What'd you think of that?
I am disgusted by that because I think that she did a great job and I think that she looked great and I think that she's highly entertaining and I don't think that, I don't understand why appearance is such a necessary thing when you look at your entertainers. And look at me. I'm highly fucking entertaining. I am not a fuck, you know, I can probably sustain third world countries on the amount of fat on my body. Okay. I mean, really, let's think about it. Okay. And so, you know, but it doesn't detract from who I am as a person, you know, and I think she looked fucking great. And oh my God, speaking of the fucking Super Bowl, have you seen the fucking racism about the Super Bowl? Have you
seen? No, but let's stick to that other topic, okay?
Okay.
Want to know what I think?
I do.
I think she made muffin tops hot in a single moment.
I didn't see any muffin tops. I don't. The woman doesn't have an ounce of fat on her fucking body. I don't understand where this is coming from. Towards the end,
in the last minute, when she went down to that just that bottom and that top shoulder pad thing. Just before she did the mic drop thing, major muffin top action, and she made muffin top sexy, if you ask me.
Yeah, but if she's just standing there, she doesn't have that. Everyone has that when you bend over. She does.
No, she and doesn't. she went on show saying, listen,
okay,
you know, I'm not in the best.
If she is considered fat, then I must be like the fuck, I should be in a fucking freak show.
I didn't
show.
Say fat, I said okay. She had a muffin top, and she made the muffin top.
I should be like illegal, okay?
But that's what the body shaming thing was about, was the muffin top thing. And let me tell you something, the muffin top was hot. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
So anyway, so I know Brim's in here and maybe he can give his view on this racism Super Bowl, where people have been calling the game racist because a team called the Patriots won over the Atlanta Falcons, and they had a white quarterback. So therefore, it's white supremacy. It's a game for white supremacy. And,
oh, get out of here.
No, seriously.
Get
hashtag Super Bowl. Look at the hashtag Super Bowl on Twitter and read what these people are saying. It's crazy shit. I mean, you know, that because the Patriots, that means that apparently the word patriot is now equal to racist Nazi now, and because it's a big conspiracy for white supremacy within the NFL, because they allowed the Patriots to win the Super Bowl and didn't ban them or stop them because of their name. So
let me tell you, it's gotten crazy, first of all, I don't care much for the Atlanta Falcons, and I hate the Patriots, but those fuckers earned that win, okay, and it was an exciting game in the last quarter. So.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people were really, you know, excited about the game. I didn't personally watch it, but I was, from my reading.
But half the commercials were there to shame me.
Yeah,
okay.
I'm a little upset over the wage gap one. I'm just slightly upset about that because it was very, very, very shallow and horrible, and it conveyed the wrong message, and it hit all of the things. It promoted violence. It promoted oppression. It promoted being shallow. It promoted all of the things that women don't want to be. Okay, so anyway. So, you know, I mean, and I think this is the thing. I think that people are just bitching just to bitch now. I mean, it's not about issues. It's just finding any tiny little thing you can find to fucking bitch about, and that's what people are doing. And I threw my game in there, and I'm trying to have my discussions because I'm really interested in talking to people. You know me. You know I like to talk to people. So
I'm glad you're doing the male monologues. I think they're great. I think they're great. I approve. Keep doing it.
So yeah, I don't know. And call them political. I mean, a lot of them probably are, but I just think that it's a different, it's like what I see. So it's not just like, oh my God, this is so wrong. You know, it's just like, it's, here's what I see. Let's chat about it, you know? So if you all have any liberal friends that you're all sick of, just send them my way. I'll talk to them all fucking day long. I'll have a blast doing it too.
Hey, you know, my take on it is, people.
Lady Gaga is gorgeous and she's talented and she did her fucking job, and people need to calm the fuck down, okay? Because now, you know that she's like a Nazi sympathizer now, you know? And
who is?
Lady Gaga.
Oh, okay.
You know, because she didn't turn her halftime show into a political statement. So, she didn't do that, you know, she actually did her job and entertained a bunch of people who were tired of fucking politics. then, yeah. you know, they're calling her all of these horrible things, and now they're attacking her the way she looked, and it's just, it's ridiculous. And
okay, so you're standing up on top of an open stadium, right?
Yeah.
You're in a harness, you got cables on, okay?
Yeah.
I don't care how big the cables are, okay?
Yeah.
I ain't jumping off that thing.
She didn't.
She didn't?
No, all that, when she was standing up there with all the drones behind her, that was all taped the week before.
Oh.
She jumped off of a platform and came down, but she didn't jump off the roof of the stadium.
It looked like she did.
Yeah, that's the whole purpose of it. But they can't have, you can't have fly drones over the Super Bowl. And there's regulations and rules regarding that, and then the safety issue. So all of that was taped a week beforehand, and then she did jump off of a platform and fly down on, but it was like a crane. It wasn't like she jumped off the top of the stadium. So
I'm not jumping off a crane either.
You know, so she did jump, but it wasn't like she came flying from like a helicopter or something. You know, she didn't Bear Grylls into the fucking Super Bowl. But yeah, it wasn't like what. Now, I don't know what happened to her when she jumped. She caught the football and jumped off. I don't know if she just fell onto a mat on the freaking field. I don't know what happened with that, but which I thought was pretty cool. And I thought that was a neat little thing, and I'm glad she caught the football. So,
hey, you know what? It sure was a terrific halftime show.
It was. I think she did a really good job. And, you know, and as much as I wanted to hate it, because, you know, I really didn't hate it. I thought it was a fantastic halftime show. And
I was surprised.
I liked it a lot better than Beyonce's, I'll tell you that.
Do you want to hear the stuff that I think about when I saw it? First of all, and I don't even know why I noticed this, but every time you've ever seen her as a blonde, it's been a wig up until this time.
Yeah, and she actually fucking sang too. So,
yeah, but she actually dyed her hair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think
what's that?
I think she's been blonde for a while.
Mm-mm. No. No, she had dark brown hair in December.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it looked like her real hair.
So. A friend of mine is a friend of hers.
Oh.
And she can walk down the street in public and have nobody spot her because she doesn't look anything like that in real life. But she's recently dyed her hair.
Well, good for her.
Yeah, good for her. It's kind of cool. I just noticed that shit because it's like I actually know what she looks like when she's not, you know, when she's Stephanie and when she's not.
I mean, I'm sure she's a lovely person, and you know, more power to her. You know, and I just think that people just need to, I don't know, find a hobby. I don't know what's happening.
Yeah.
And I found a hobby in discussing, talking shit to people, you know, not that I'm talking shit because I'm not, I'm actually trying, you know, and I've been having a lot of fun doing research, you know, I know that sounds so strange and like, you know, like it's a what the fuck moment, but I'm really, really enjoying it. You know, I'm enjoying doing my research and trying to formulate opinions like my last one, about, the sociology and communism, you know, and it led me down this like rabbit hole into like trying to prove, you know, the schools are, you know, having this, you know, it's so conspiracy theory-ish. I should wear a hat when I do it, my tinfoil hat when I do this, but you know, and you know, as the more I researched, the more I looked into it, and it was like, okay, so, you know, I found ties to like, you know, fiat currency and, you know, the fucking economy and how, you know, they're dumbing down the schools and indoctrinating them into socialism to keep the, you know, the fiat dollar and the petrol dollar, you know, and all this stuff. And I'm just like, okay, I don't need to write a goddamn thesis on this shit.
You know, what's funny though, is I spent so much of my life, I spent a number of years as a research assistant. Okay. And I spent a number of my number of years of my life as a psychoanalyst and psychotherapist, and I spent a number of years of my life as a analyst for the Office of Naval Research. And you know something? I don't want to do research ever again.
I've just really been having a lot of fun, you know, trying to, you know, formulate. I'm having a lot of fun writing. I think that's pretty much what I think. I've just really been having fun coming up with arguments and citing evidence and researching it and looking at all the angles and coming up with, you know, some sort of coherent statement, you know, instead of just Trump's bad, you know, or
yeah,
fucking Nazis, you know. And it's like, no.
Stop calling
people Nazis. Stop it.
Yeah.
You know?
Trump is bad. Well, what's bad about him? Look at his hair.
Yeah. They want to take away your rights. What rights do they want to take from you? Well, what about Roe versus Wade? Do you understand how the Supreme Court works? I mean, yeah. Trump can't just fucking do away with a goddamn Supreme Court decision. Do you understand? Do you know what the Constitution is?
Dude, an executive order could take it all away.
No. It can't.
No.
You know?
No,
let's just can't. And then that freaking chick who was all talking about Russia, how we need to impeach Trump because fucking Russia's invading Korea, and she just, I was just like, and this woman has a job? I mean, this is our senator for crying, our representative, whoever she is, that crazy lady that wants to fucking impeach Trump. What's her name? Knock probably knows her name, Armando. But
don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, are you kidding me? You know, and oh, we should totally impeach him. It's like, well, what are you going to impeach him for exactly? Do you understand how this process works? You know, I'm like,
we don't like him. We're going to impeach him.
I don't know. So I'm trying to bring a little bit of, I don't know, like rational thought. I don't know if
rational
that's even
thoughts.
The right fucking word. I'm not sure. But
rational thoughts just fine. Go ahead. You have permission to think rationally. You know. What I do like is that you present your rational thought without kerosene, you know. And without
we can talk. I believe in the people of America that we have not lost our ability to communicate, you know. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
I think you're wrong.
Maxine Walters, that's who it is. Thank you.
I think you're a little wrong about America's ability to communicate. I mean, we are really heading in the direction of grunts, you know, and body language, because people can't communicate for shit anymore.
Well, we're rationalizing and normalizing violence, you know.
One last thing before we go.
Yeah, those people. Oh my God, do you know how the word works? Jesus Christ, you know.
One last thing before we go.
Okay.
Bestiality busts. Craigslist posts lead to arrests.
Yep.
Two Arizona men are accused of using the internet to solicit sexual encounters with animals.
Yes.
The Maricopa County Sheriff's Office, that's your county, isn't it?
Yes.
Says 47-year-old Keith Kiefer and 25-year-old Patrick Trejo put separate ads on Craigslist, both looking for sex with a dog. Detectives replied they set up dates and arrested both of them. The Arizona Humane Society says it's not surprised by the arrests, but in most cases it's hard to prosecute because animals can't testify.
Well, it's really
it was
hard
very
to get
disturbing,
the
and I hope the courts aggressively go after these people, because if they'll do this to the animals, they could do it to kids or who knows what. There's something wrong with them, says the Humane Society's Dr. Nancy Bradley. Mal, they busted up the animal prostitution ring around the corner from your house.
Yep.
And now these guys are soliciting sex with animals.
Is it a surprise? I mean, is it a surprise? Because where are they supposed to go now that they've busted the fucking prostitution ring? You know, I mean, where it left a void in the whole market of bestiality. So it's no surprise that they turned to Craigslist. I mean, you know.
Mel, now, just between you and me, are you aware that that news story that I sent you the clip to is absolutely real?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you find that amusing in light of other knowledge?
I did find it amusing. I really, truly did. And it just, what was it? Oh God, there was a comedian. I don't know who it was, but they had this joke where they're just like, oh my God, you know, I just got out of jail, you know? And they're like, oh, what for? And he's like, oh, bestiality. And they're like, holy crap, you know, do you have, what happened? And like, oh, well, they had to let me go because the German Shepherd couldn't identify me in the lineup, you know? So, or something along those lines. And I thought that was hilarious. It just reminded me of that.
Just remember.
Yes, I am building a new house. I have the beginnings of walls, and they're supposed to be doing they put the board, the support beams up, yeah. I guess, for the outside walls, and they're doing the measurings, and we're going to get the trusses actually made. So they have to get all of the measurements and all the stuff for the trusses, and those are going to
email.
What?
Go ahead, tell everybody the name of this town you're moving to.
Snowflake. I am going to be living in Snowflake.
Oh, you're going to be amongst all the snowflake. What are people in that town called? Snowflakers?
Snowflakians.
Snowflakians? Or are they just called snowflakes?
They're just called snowflakes. I don't know. But what's hilarious is that it is a Mormon survivalist town. So there's a bunch of Mormon survivalists. And actually, you know, people are talking about religion. I would like to just shout out to the Mormons. I would like to throw a shout out just because you know what the church did? So, okay, so we have a neighbor who's an elderly gentleman, and he was a bishop or something in the Mormon church up there. And the church actually, every like single day, the church sends people to his house and checks up on him and makes sure that, you know, he's eating and that he has food. They bring him food. They take him to the doctor. They do a lot. They cake, you know, they clean up his yard and do his dishes. You know, these little old women from the Mormon church. Okay. So yep. He's our neighbor. So I send bread and stuff up to him and stuff to when they go up north and everything. And our other neighbor is Mormon as well. So because we're building a house, the Mormon church is sending missionaries out on the weekends to volunteer to help build our house. So shout out to the Mormons. If you guys are, any of you know Mormons, yeah, kudos, you know, because it's amazing. Without any kind of, you know, they don't want anything. They're actually having a really good time. The little missionaries, they're like 19, 20 year old kids, but they're learning and they're helping and they're, you know, doing something, you know, and so shout out to them. Snowflake is 3 hours away from where I currently live. Up north, it's 6,000 elevation. It's up on a High Plains mountain, so yeah,
awesome.
You know. So yeah, so I, you know, I think that that's really cool. You know, that the church, because we don't belong to the Mormon church, but because our neighbors and stuff are, you know, Mormon and involved with the church, you know, they I guess told them that we're building a house, and yeah, so they're sending out volunteers to come help us for free. You know, without
awesome.
Any.
Awesome.
Not asking all for right. anything in return, you know.
All
so.
Right. So, closing thoughts. ProVape is gone.
It's a sad, sad time in the.
Some people saw
industry.
It coming, but for different reasons. Other people are sad that they're gone, and I, for one, am sad that they're gone. But I'm happy for them. I'm happy for David and Phil. They're great people. I hope they really enjoy their retirement. David plans on taking a couple of years off, and then he's going to be, he plans on volunteering at an animal shelter, which is pretty fucking awesome. I don't know what Phil plans on doing. I suspect he may move back to the Binghamton area where he's originally from, but good people, great products, great company, went out strong, and when you see people bad-mouthing them because they didn't keep up, anybody who's left in this thread, 15 of you, shut those people down, you know. seriously, you know, tell people, company's gone, but they did it right. And they did it right from start to finish.
Yeah, you know, I'm sad to see them go, but I am happy that, you know, they were able to accomplish their dream, and, you know, that's amazing.
I'm happy for them, and I think they need they're going to get a well-deserved rest, and, you know, if there's a billion lives to save, those guys put a pretty good fucking dent in it.
Yeah.
And I think that's pretty awesome. I think they did great work, and their products will live many, many, many more years. So, you know, if you got a ProVary, stop looking at it like it's obsolete, and think about what an amazing device is. Mm-hmm. And one day it may be your only working PV.
And
so that's
safe.
It.
Stay safe. Come add me on Facebook. You know, my monologues, come have a conversation with me, you know.
And
let's talk.
I guess we'll see you next week.
All right. Bye, guys. Have a good weekend.
Bye-bye.